Bon retour et bienvenue à cette session d'après-midi. Thank you for joining us for this afternoon session. I'm going to be very brief. No introductions. We're going to go right into the panel, given the time that is now. Claude Schreyer is joining us from the Canada Council for the Arts. He's in Ottawa on WebEx, and we'll give him first a right to speak. He's agreed to stay on till the question period, I believe. Yes. And then read your notes. If you, we have great speakers. They have great lives and so much to say, but it'll be up to them to do it. Claude, à toi.
OK, bonjour. Hi, everyone. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yes? OK, good. Well, I was just in Regina last week for the Saskatchewan Arts Alliance meeting, and I reconnected with my former colleague, Jen Budney. Hello, Jen. And Annette Isabel. And they asked me to speak a bit about the topic today, which is governance and cultural diversity. And I'm happy to do that. I can give an example of what our new funding model will do in this regard and maybe answer any questions you have. I'm not really a specialist on the convention, but I've been following it for years. And it so happens that tomorrow, Daniel Klisch is coming here to council to talk to us about the report that just came out. So it's certainly in the air, and it's really exciting for me to not only participate, but to listen in to the panel today. So I'm sure you know the Canada Council. We've been working actively on what we might call cultural diversity for about 25 years. In the early 90s, Joyce Seaman set up the Equity Office. And ever since then, we've been trying to walk our talk, to have a culturally diverse workforce, to have equity policies, to be as representative as possible of the Canadian population. And we've done pretty well. And we've also had very, forward-looking equity policies in terms of capacity building and many of those things. But when we designed the new funding model, we wanted to start building in more clearly assessment criteria and objectives into programs. And so you might have heard there's been some talk in the community that in our institutions program, one of the objectives is to encourage diversity in arts organizations so that they reflect their communities and inform and it informs their public engagement responsibilities. So the notion of responsibility, the idea that one of our objectives in funding an institution is to make sure that it is reflective of its communities. And then we built in an assessment criteria that I'll read just the beginning, to reflect the diversity of your organization's geographic community or region, notably through artistic programming, organizational makeup, and audiences with regards to the inclusion and engagement of Aboriginal people, culturally diverse groups, people with deaf who are deaf or have disabilities and official. So that's a way for when you appear an institution, festival, organizations involved in public engagement, that they will need to present their case as to how they govern themselves, the needs of their staff, so that it's reflective of not only their mandate, but of the community that they work in. So in that sense, the Canada Council has taken a very clear position that, of our expectations from organizations, and we'll see how it goes in the peer assessment process, and then whether grants go up or go down in terms of how organizations score. But it's a major step for us to really have built it into the criteria and make it very clear that it's an expectation on the part of the Canada Council as a public funder. Otherwise, we also created an Indigenous program that you might have heard about that's being led by Stephen Loft called Creating, Knowing, and Sharing. And that also has governance implications because the organizations that can apply are a very wide range of Indigenous-led organizations that each have their own governance systems, and some of them are quite different from non-Indigenous organizations. And we've created a space specifically for Indigenous arts and culture of First Nation, Inuit, and Métis people. So it's a really big departure for us, and we're very excited about having this program available for any Indigenous artist or arts organization who can apply to this program or to any of the regular programs. So again, part of the new funding model is to further our commitment to, in this case, self-governance by Indigenous people within the Canada Council structure and in terms of equity to ensure that the organizations that we fund are as equitable as possible within the mandate that they've given themselves. So So I'll stop there. I know there's other people who want to speak, and maybe after the other presentations, I could answer some questions, and we can talk through this WebEx format. Does that work okay?
I was really pleased to see the Canada Council's new requirements for diversity on boards of the larger cultural organizations. I think I want to try to connect a few dots from the day. What Carol Gray, I said this morning about how we tend to privilege form over content, but it's really all about the content, why we're here today and why we're so interested in culture, I think is really important. And she said content is spirit. And on some level, all of our culture is only intangible. It is about the resilience of people. It is about how we know the world and how we relate to each other. But we do privilege, in terms of policy, making the institutions and the forms over the content. And we can see that in the way that we fund organizations. Eleonora Belfiore, who's an academic in the UK, wrote, "The fact that so much of public money goes to art forms, the consumption of which is effectively still the preserve of the well-educated and the relatively wealthy, after over 50 years of pro-access policies, is undoubtedly a source of unease." So in Canada, like the UK, it's still the wealthiest few, typically white, well-educated, upper-middle-class Canadians who access the publicly funded arts. And the Canada Council has, up until now, had policies to encourage diversity in arts organizations. There was a great metaphor that was presented by David Kyle, the new CEO of the SASC Arts Board, and he said that, you know, in his mind, maybe the job of arts funders is simply to do no harm, much like doctors. And somebody in the audience said, "But you know, if you've got an injury and you're working with a physiotherapist, sometimes you have to push through the pain. You have to do a little bit of hurt, not harm, but there has to be hurt in order to heal." And I thought that was a really apt metaphor for the kinds of policies up until now the Canada Council and other organizations have had to encourage diversity. For 20 years, there's been an Aboriginal curator-in-residence program, a culturally diverse curator-in-residence program for art museums. This is just one example. They're across other sectors, there have been other kinds of programs, which have given 100% of all funding to the curators. Adrian was a lucky recipient of one of these grants. I say in jest, somewhat. and the institutions receiving these funds didn't have to change a thing. Everything was handed to them. There was no hurt in the healing process. They didn't have to shell out a penny or engage in any real self-reflection. And I think as we've heard today, we all hate self-reflection, like the really hard kind. We all hate that kind of self-reflection that causes us to change. And so I think we need to be pushed. We need to have that physiotherapist because institutions are not doing it on their own. So I want to applaud the Canada Council's move towards asking organizations to go through a little bit of hurt, and probably even more could be done in that way, and I would hope that other arts boards follow suit. Recent studies, there's been a really great report released in the UK by Jeffrey Krosick and Patricia Kaczynska called Understanding the Value of Arts and Culture. It came out in the last couple of weeks. And one of the issues that we have is having no data. And Sylvia this morning talked about Hill Strategies in Ottawa. They've just announced, as of yesterday, I think, that they are not going to be providing any more data on the arts and culture because the data doesn't exist. There's nothing more they can pull. So in Canada, we have almost no data. But in the UK, they've been doing a much better job. And they have discovered that despite our heavy investments in the major cultural organizations and the kind of rallying that politicians do around building the world-class centers, that quality of life and community resilience seems to be strengthened much more by smaller kinds of cultural organizations, live music venues, artist studios, those kinds of things. So that again to me speaks about, I guess, the subject of this panel, which was governance models, which is still thinking about the structure, whether we have a policy governance board or a cooperative, things like that. I'm not sure that matters. I think it really is about the people, and the way that we can best be in touch with people is by thinking very much on grassroots levels, and maybe pulling our attention away from some of the major investments that we're doing that are so slow to change, that need to go through some hurt before they're really serving the people in an equitable way. And I don't know how much time I have left. I wanted to try and keep this really short. I think one final thing. I think that we're not going to make a whole lot of progress in this area until we sit down with other sectors to talk about cultural policy. So if culture is ultimately intangible, it doesn't make sense to me that we talk about cultural policy only amongst people working in designated cultural institutions, but we need to sit down with educators and libraries and all kinds of other sectors in order to make the changes from the ground up that are necessary to build that resilience into our collective culture, which means having the diversity. That's it. Thank you.
Jen Budney, ladies and gentlemen.
Jen Budney.
And now Adrian.
How do I get it? This to come back.
Okay, ukinuksukwa, nistutidanagapu iskumapi, iksukapi. It's good to be here on this land. Thank you to Isabel and the organization for asking me to be a part of this, for which I'm very grateful. So I'm coming looking at governance from the perspective of an artist, and like all artists, or most anyway, you either getting it or you giving it. And so I thought I would right away sort of speak to this idea that as artists, in a sense, we're entrepreneurs. We're self-employed, and sometimes we rely on organizations for assistance to help us realize our visions and such. For me, being First Nations from Blackfoot, Siksika in southern Alberta, and two-spirited as well, there's a number of sort of battles to confront, and I think it's one of the things that I think it's really interesting about being an artist. So for me, directly relates to cultural practices of within two-spirited practice are not necessarily that, but also the contrary, the trickster, the one who often reflects back to society that which is going on, but in a most ridiculous way, so that society, in a sense, can take a look at itself and ask some of those tough questions. And sometimes it's done very brutally. And sometimes it's done very fun, in a very fun way. So for me, Buffalo Boy has been that character that I've utilized or used within the performance genre to bring a lot of these issues to the forefront, especially the construction of indigenous identity within Western culture. So the more brutal one is the shaman exterminator, who's a little bit more tough and a little bit more menacing in the sense to sort of bring forward a lot of these issues. But it comes back, back into cultural practices. And for me, you know, the erasure and the genocide that occurred with the invasion is one of those things that it wiped out a lot of these practices, in particular with two-spirited being. So for me, it's been a reclamation and looking at those practices from a Blackfoot perspective and seeing how what we did within our tribe, like what were our roles within the tribe. And often I'm finding new and exciting things that, in particular with the Blackfoot, two-spirited people actually played a significant role in the Sundance, for which I didn't know for many years. That's a governance structure. That is something that is, we are integral within the systems within our tribes. So how do I take that out and try to bring it within Western context? So within Indigenous cultures, there are many sort of metaphors that talk to how communities work, how governance works, the construction of a teepee is just but one. The Great Interruption, or the residential schools, for which I'm a survivor of residential schools, so I have intimate knowledge of those systems, have greatly caused distrust. I do not trust institutions as far as I can throw them, and as a result, I haven't been able to be a part of them for too long, which actually I don't mind, but at the same time, it has caused me a significant barrier to actually participate, and because of outspokenness as being an artist, often blacklists. So this is a reality that we artists also face within our within this Western construction, is that the reality of actually being othered again. So of course, you know, how do you speak to that? You again use the systems, use the system itself to show itself where it's at. So again, you know, using the material culture of residential schools and of Blackfoot societies and stuff like that to sort of again bring that to the forefront. Of course, there's all sorts of factors such as resource development and all those things that play a role. But then looking back into our Western culture, is it beyond redemption? And in particular, this installation speaks to that. It also speaks to cultural practices within Blackfoot, which is matriarchal, the Motokiks, the Buffalo Women's Society and such, and ensuring that those voices are very part and very center to how we govern. But when we really govern, we got to judge. And this comes from a performance that Laurie Blondeau and I did a number of years ago, talking about cultural appropriation and racism within Canada. And this one was Canadian Idol No More, for which we judged 10 candidates, which were chosen by other people, not us, as being the most racist people in Canada. So we had a trial, and actually at the end of the trial, the audience voted as to who was the most racist, and you can bet who was. And the sentencing was last October, and the sentencing he was convicted. Okay. So, and again, it's also too, looking back to the treaties, and I was part of a process called Making Treaty 7, looking at how those original spirit intents of the intent of those agreements and what they mean for us today and how we move through them today. This is a bit of protest during Idle No More on my nation, again, bringing that to the forefront. Identity issues, the construction, again, you have Sitting Bull, the wooden Indian, and the real Indian. So again, it's all that whole idea of how do we start recognizing this? And it's again, looking at our history and pointing back at Columbus. And I think what I'll do is I'll probably stop here, and this is just how ways we can go forward. And this is from a monument that we created here in Saskatoon with myself, Jean-Sébastien Gauthier, and my partner Ian Grove, Happy Grove. And so this particular thing was commissioned by the Whitecap Dakota First Nations, and looking at the spirit of alliance and how we have to move forward in the same spirit. And this here exists in Saskatoon. And the process of doing this was high in consultation with the community and with seeking to educate the greater, our greater community. And Prince Edward was there as a royal representative, and he actually said during the thing that the British, I don't think we quite got it right. Thank you.
There's a lot of material for debate. I think we've heard from three different, very different perspectives, but also polarizing, should I say, questions, interventions on grassroots and informal governance, identity, and beyond redemption, and efforts, obviously, to reform and to be proactively sort of promoting diversity within institutions. Anyone?
This, I think you're probably the good panel to pose this question, but it could be broader. Sorry. Spontaneous nerves. I'm a curator, and I noticed that there are a tremendous amount of Indigenous artists who are, I don't want to say dominating the field in Canada, but I think that some of the best artists in Canada are Indigenous, particularly in the younger generation. And I wonder, partially in light of what the changes are with the Canada Council and the emphasis on more funding for Indigenous artists and programming, and the Natitian Foundation awards, whether the rise in the number of successful, well-known, exhibiting, collected, commercial gallery represented Indigenous artists in the last, like, say, 10 years, is that a result of some policy initiatives or funding initiatives that happened at some point in the past? Or is it a grassroots path?
I could probably sort of speak to that a bit. I think it's a combination. I think most definitely grassroots in the sense that it comes from our communities, and our communities are incredibly encouraging to us, to our elders and our parents and everything like that, is get out there, get the education you need, and use that within the Western system to move forward. And just because we're in a public forum, I just want to say also thank you to the Saskatchewan Arts Board, the Canada Council. These organizations have been very integral into, as I can speak for myself as an artist, to my success. The grants that I've received over the years have very much helped me put my work into the forefront. So I think that's very well. But there's also another issue here as to what happens when the grants don't happen. And sustainability for the artist, too, is a big issue right now, I think. And how do individual artists sustain themselves without going outside their work to make a living? So that's another issue that I'm grappling with as an artist right now, reality. You know, how do we manage to keep ourselves going and sustaining and contribute to a community, and when there are no grants, or you don't get it, or you've already maxed out, or, you know, something like that.
And, I would agree with Adrian, and I would say that actually if we hadn't had Tribe active in the art scene, I don't think we would be where we are right now in Canada in terms of acknowledging and exhibiting and circulating the work of Indigenous artists. So that's Saskatoon people. But some of the things coming out from the Canada Council, the Reconciliation Fund, that's directly from the Truth and Reconciliation's 94 recommendations. They singled Canada Council out for creating that Reconciliation Artists Fund. There are other recommendations that deal specifically with museums and commemorations, and we haven't heard yet publicly from the Canadian Museum Association, as far as I know, or CAMDO, Canadian Art Museum Directors Organization, if they're going to respond to the recommendations in any way. But it's, I think, in terms of the Natitian Foundation awards, I think lots has changed in Canada, and little has changed as well. But on some level, there is a recognition that the celebration of Canada's 150th anniversary, without drawing attention to the fact of colonialism, is obscene. So there are some organizations, certainly not all, that are trying to not be obscene, right? And that's kind of what it is. It's just trying not to be obscene. We have to acknowledge that. There's so much that still has to change, though. And I think in terms of the funding for Indigenous artists, Claude should speak to this, but you know, from my experience going to various conferences, the work that young Indigenous artists are doing in terms of working with community groups and the kinds of changes that they're making in communities is so powerful, and I would be hard-pressed to find other communities where that kind of amazing work is going on, I think. Mm-hmm.
And maybe just to add to that, with success also becomes the issues of success, like things like tensions between ideas of traditional and contemporary. There's a lot of gray areas in there. The whole process of avoiding pan-Indianism, you know, this whole idea that the fact is we all come from different communities, and even within our own communities, we come from different clans who have different ways of doing things than the other parts. So how do we not buy into this sort of one solution fits all? Competition between Indigenous artists, which, you know, is an issue. Criticism is another one. How do we critique each other without taking it too personally? Who are the experts? And why are they the experts within our community? And we've got to start asking those questions of, like, who is it, you know, who's put forward and why are they put forward and what actual message are they giving? So I think those are some of the things that we need to also keep in mind as we move forward and how this blossoming sort of, our blossoming world of indigenous art.
Well, I agree with you, Adrian. We were just talking about some of those issues with our CEO, Simon Beau, last year. In a way, it's a departure for the Canada Council to have created this program, because before we had fragmented programs in the disciplines, and we did a review a couple of years ago, and we were told by the Indigenous consultant that it would make sense to consolidate programs and to have an open space for Indigenous arts and culture, but also access to other programs. And all the things you talked about and more are on the table for Stephen Loft and his team to work through protocols. There's a lot of catching up to do in terms of integrating, or I guess making it clear that there's an Indigenous space at the Canada Council, and inviting other agencies to do similar kind of work. But it's a long-term relationship and commitment. And what the council has done in its strategic plan that was just released 10 days ago is commit to a long-term renewal of the relationship with Indigenous people, with reconciliation as one of the bases from which we want to work from. And there is some pain involved in there for survivors, for those who are trying to understand, not so much pain, but they need to make an effort to really reach out. And art, we know, is a great way to connect people. So we feel that we're on relatively solid ground right now, but the issues you raise are real, and it's going to be a lot of work that's going to be necessary to move forward in a positive way. And we'll probably have to adjust as we go, but we have a strong team of Indigenous staff, and we have a board of Canada Council who are strongly endorsed a direction towards reconciliation, and so that's what we're going to do the next few years.
Thank you. Yes, sir. Introduce yourself, please.
Yes, my name is Jim Hodges, and I'm an independent producer in the performing arts industry. Referring back to what Jen, you mentioned earlier about inclusivity, about talking to different groups of people, meeting with all sorts of providers within the industry, I think that the independent producers of Canada should be talked to, should be included in that conversation. Now, in Western Canada, there may be a few of us, but I know that certainly in places like Quebec, where I've worked a lot with cultural organizations in Quebec, the artist and the producer walk hand in hand with each other. One can't do without the other. So I think it's important that people like myself and others are included in those conversations, because I think we do provide some inside information about how that works. Thank you.
Thank you. That's a really good point.
One last question or one last comment from the room?
I just wanted to add that when I was talking about the Aboriginal Curator in Residence program, after 20 years of that program, today there are only 4 Indigenous curators in art museums in the country. So that's an important point to make, is that without that hurt, the organizations aren't actually making any real changes.
I just have a question, and I don't know if it's a question, and I don't know if it's relevant, but in the music world, when I was presenting Music Action and Factor, this has been delegated to the industry, basically. The ministry just sort of defines the program in a very broad sense, and there's a memorandum. Could there be one day where, for Indigenous groups, and it's self-managed and self-organized, or should it be always within the structure of the Canada Council? Is that something that's realistic or even to discuss?
I don't know. Probably there'll be an evolution in that direction, absolutely. But I don't know. Sometimes it's good to have objectivity a bit.
I think that there's a lot of self-management going on already, and that happens particularly in the smaller organizations. And it's just that we focus on the major, the large organizations, where they're it's funny because we're creative people and they're like the most hierarchical organizations. So I don't know why we continue to work that way. We should be a bit more creative.
Claude, any comment on that or any thoughts on that?
Well, I think right now there's a certain national momentum with the TRC and just the announcement at the UN this week. There's major changes going on, so it's a real opportunity to to move things forward, to get more information flowing, to create new networks. The North has been severely underfunded for years, so there's infrastructure needs both in the South and in the North. So there's a lot of issues that we can tackle in parallel on different fronts, not just the Canada Council, but the Canada Council can provide leadership and funding in areas. So I think it's a time of change, and we can really sort of seize the day and move forward in ways that weren't possible a few years ago, and there's an alignment now that is really interesting, and I hope we can all take advantage of it.
And with that note, I thank our panelists. I think this was a great panel. Thank you all.
It's good. Thank you, Claude.
Merci, Claude.
Thank you. See you again. Cheers.